Welcome, everybody. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone. Winning zone.
Today, I will be taught the word of God. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I am ready to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone.
Winning zone.
We're saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole. And I can tell everyone I know. Come on.
You thought I was worth saving.
So you came.
So you came and changed my
you
life.
Thought I was worth
you thought
keeping.
I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up inside.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was
you thought I was to die for.
So you sacrificed.
So you sacrificed your life. So I could be free. So I could be whole.
And I can
so
tell,
I
everyone,
could tell everyone
you thought I was
you
worth.
Thought I was worth saving.
So you came.
So you came and changed my
you
life.
Thought I was
you
worth
thought
keeping.
I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up inside.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was
you thought I was to die for.
So you sacrificed.
So you sacrificed
your life.
So I could, so be, I could free. Be free.
So I could
so
be whole.
I could be whole.
So I could tell
so
everyone.
I could tell everyone.
So you came.
So you came and changed my
you thought I was
you
worth
thought
keeping.
I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up inside.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was
you thought I was the devil.
So you sacrificed.
So you sacrificed.
So I could be free.
So I could be free.
I could be old.
So I could be whole.
And I could tell everyone. So you came.
So you came and changed my
you
life.
Thought I was
you
worth
thought
keeping.
I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up inside.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was
the devil.
So you sacrificed.
So you sacrificed your life.
I could be free.
So I could be free.
I could be whole.
So I could be whole.
I could tell
so
everyone.
I could tell everyone.
I am free.
Because I am free.
I am whole.
Because I am whole.
And I can tell everyone I know. I know.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Glory. To the God who changed my life.
To the God who changed my life.
And I will praise you
forever.
I'll worship you
forever.
I'll give you glory
forever.
Because I am free.
Because I am free.
I am
because
whole.
I am whole.
And I want to
say.
you
forever.
I'll worship you
forever.
I'll give you glory
forever.
We love you, Lord.
Forever.
We worship you
forever.
We praise your
forever.
Name because of
forever.
You.
Forever.
I'm saved.
Forever.
Saved. Thought I was worth saving, so you sacrificed your life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. He thought I was to die for. He thought you were to die for. Hallelujah. He thought I was to die for. Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He gave his life. He thought I was to die for. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed your life. So I could be free. Hallelujah. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. Worth saving, so he came and changed your life. He thought you were worth keeping, so he cleaned you up inside. He thought you were to die for. He thought you were to die for. He thought I was to die for. So he sacrificed his life so we could be free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you came.
So you came and changed my life.
You thought I was worth keeping.
So you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was to die for. So you sacrificed.
So you sacrificed.
So I could be free.
So I could be free.
So you could be whole. You can tell everyone you know.
Changed my life. You thought I was
keeping
us,
for giving your life.
So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for.
So you sacrificed
your life,
so I could be
free,
so I could be whole,
and I could tell everyone I know.
God who changed my life, and I will praise you
forever.
We will worship you
forever.
We will give you glory
forever.
Because we are free.
Because I am free.
We are whole.
Because I am whole.
We can tell everyone we know. We know. Praise
forever.
I'll worship
forever.
I'll give you glory
forever.
We bless your name
forever.
For who you are
forever.
You're the King of kings
forever.
You're the Son of sons
forever.
God, we love
forever.
You, Lord. We
forever.
Bless your name. You
forever.
Are worthy for your
forever.
Grace and your
forever.
Mercy, Lord. We thank you
forever.
We thank
forever.
You. We thank
forever,
you, Lord.
Forever.
And I will tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. So he cleaned me up inside. He thought I was to die for.
Hallelujah.
When you walked in my shoes, you know. He thought I was to die for. Hallelujah.
Greetings and welcome to Church Online. It is always a pleasure and a privilege to come into your home or wherever you are and to bring you ministry from God's word, ministry in song, and we want to bless you, to encourage you, to lift you up, and let you know that everything's going to be all right because God is on your side. That's right. If God is for you, who can be against you? There's nothing like the love of God, and I want to assure you of the great, amazing love that God has for you. His love for you is unmatched. Nothing can match the love of God. It's never ending. It's relentless, and no matter what you're going through, God is going to see you through it. You're coming out on top because you are victorious, all right? So I'm going to take you right in to today's experience. Be blessed. God loves you. We love you at Summit Church.
Y'all ready for the word? Yeah. Summit, y'all ready for the word?
Yeah.
I said, are you ready? Praise the Lord. Let me get ready. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to jump right into some things. And I want you to see a clear difference between what the law does and what grace does. The law was never meant to make us righteous, but to show us our need of a Savior. The law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. The Bible says the law, it strengthens sin. Now, there's nothing wrong with the law. The law is perfect. The issue is us. We can't keep it. We'd be all good. I mean, if we could keep that law perfectly, you'd be straight with God. I mean, if you could keep it perfectly, you'd be straight with God. There would have been no need for Jesus to come. But the issue is we can't keep it. So give up trying to keep the law. Now, a couple of weeks ago, the last time I taught this, we had a guest last week, but I want to catch you up. There, we talked about how the law actually is a ministry. When you preach the law and you go to a church that teaches law and the mixture is just the same. I gave you an example about you put a little poison into a milkshake, you wouldn't drink it, would you? Even if it's a drop. You don't try to drink around it. He's like, no, thank you, right? A little mixture, mix in a little law with grace, it still equals law. 99% law, 99% grace, 1% law equals law. The Bible calls the law, and we can really nail it down or break it down to the Ten Commandments. Well, I know we're not supposed to keep the dietary laws and those kind of law, but you really need to keep the Big Ten. But watch this. Now I'm just setting you up right now, giving you a little review. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the last time I taught, we looked at this, and it calls the Ten Commandments. Now, the Ten Commandments was what God wrote on the tablets of stone. I'm in the wrong chapter. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. If I preach the law and churches that preach the law, you know what you're getting? You're getting death. And that's why it's dangerous to preach the law. Now, the law is good. The problem is we can't keep it, all right? Now, you should thank God for this church. Because I'm giving you pure, not to pat myself on the back, but I'm giving you pure, unadulterated grace with no mixture. And that's the gospel. And I ain't ashamed of it, because it's the power of God to free you from anything that holds you back. Woo. Watch this. Don't take my word for it. Just write these scriptures down if you weren't with us last time. But if the ministry of death, 2 Corinthians 3:7, but if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away, how will the ministry of the Spirit be much more glorious? See, he's contrasting the law, which he calls the ministry of death, which was written and engraved on stones. We know what was written and engraved on a stone. The Big Ten. So Paul is telling us here that the ministry of the Spirit is more glorious. What does the ministry of the Spirit give us? Life. This is what grace gives us, life. Got grace, got life. Got the law, got death. Got mixture, got death. And the law condemns. It also says, in verse 9, for if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. So the ministry, grace is referred to as the ministry of righteousness. When you're under grace, you understand that you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. When you're under grace, it's also called the ministry of the Spirit, because we're led by the Spirit, not by rules. Now, let me lay this on you. So those of you that think you can keep the law. I'm going to take a little risk here. And so, now I'm talking about the difference between law and grace, but let me give you a subtitle. Donald Trump, Barack Obama, and the law. I thank God I'm in a free church, man. Hallelujah. Now, I say that because those names, when you bring them up, they provoke emotions and feelings in people. And I only bring them up just to show you that you can't keep the law. So that can be a subtitle. That's all right to say these names in church. Say Donald Trump. Say I love Donald Trump. Barack Obama. Say I love Barack Obama. Yeah, see then see how that though got that little raise. Okay, and I had a subtitle to that. Okay, so Barack Obama, Donald Trump, no necessary order, and the law. Okay, here it is. Here, I got it now. Here's a subtitle to that. I got your attention now, don't you? Some folks are normally falling asleep right now. They perked up. What the pastor going to say? I hope you don't say nothing bad about my guy, whoever that is. So, but I'm really dealing with the law. I'm going to show you can't keep it. I'm sure you can't keep it. Here's a subtitle. Losing your religion over politics. And I would to God you lose your religion. A political kind of title will help you lose your religion. And when I say religion, see, Christianity is not religion. It's a relationship. It's a relationship with God. See, and one of our members, Beth Copperidge, she had something on her Facebook page about, she said she doesn't, I'm going to paraphrase it a little bit. She said, I don't use the word hate very much, but I hate cancer. I agree with that. I hate cancer. There's a couple of things that really stand out to me that I hate, and I do. I mean, if you ever were affected by anybody in your family or close friends that are dealing with cancer and believing God for healing for cancer, I'm telling you, you understand what I'm saying. You understand what Beth is saying. You know, you hate cancers. Here's something else I hate: religion. And it's all over Facebook. You see people, man, they, you know, and some of these law keepers. Oh yeah, I keep the law. Yeah, yeah. Well, let's look at a big one. I'm not even in my notes. I'm all over the place right now, but that's okay. Watch this. And we say some silly things, stuff I used to say. And I thought about one thing that was really stupid. Well, the Bible said we can love people. Like I love Donald Trump, or I love President Obama, but the Bible said I don't have to like them. I mean, what in the heck does that mean even? I thought about it, like, what does that really mean? Anybody ever heard that? Isn't that kind of dumb? I mean, like, how are we going to love people on our job? And it's like, oh, okay, I get it now. This person that's treating me bad and loving your enemies, it didn't say like your enemies. It said love your enemies. So, dude, let me tell you one thing. I love you, but I don't like you. How does that play out? Is that just me? I mean, how does that, do you ever think about what? How do you do that? I love them, but I do not like them. If you love somebody, you're going to like them. You might not agree with that. But how am I going, because see, to me it boils down to how am I going to treat somebody? But the good news is, see, I'm really talking about this biggie. Like if you look at the Big Ten and you think you can keep the commandments, let's look at the biggest of the ten. In Matthew 22, see, some of you done broke the law already. As soon as I said Donald Trump, you know, you start hating me. Like, how could he even bring that up in church? You look at what he did and look at what you did. You already forgot the song we sang. Crying and all that kind of stuff. See, I got to bring these polarizing, figures up to some people. They're polarizing. You know, you just mention their name and people have a hissy fit. I've been around people. You bring around Barack Obama. I've been in presence of people and you know, they make it a point to sometimes say something about him to see if it stimulates something in me. they're just dumb enough to think something like that would offend me. So I just go on about my business, man. What people say and think or whatever, you know, my deal is this thing that I do have a point to all of this. Those of you who think you can keep the law, that's what I'm dealing with. Some of you, you're good. You know you can't keep it. But I'm gonna hit the rest of you now because you think, yeah, oh, yeah, I can keep the Big Ten. Now, Jesus, watch this. The Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees. They gathered together, and then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him, saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Now, what's the biggie? Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." What two? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You think you keep that all the time? Seriously? What happens when you, them Facebook posts about Donald Trump or those Facebook posts about Barack Obama and you think you can keep the law? It's like you love your neighbor. You don't even like your neighbor sometimes, let alone love them. So give it up. None of us keep the law. Here's my point. None of us keep it all the time. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word today. Amen. All right. Galatians chapter 1. Do y'all see my point? You cannot keep the law. And God doesn't want us to keep the law. The law is a ministry of death. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. And as soon as you miss it, man, you get your head hanged down. Man, I thought I was doing pretty good, and man, doggone it. And then you get into guilt and condemnation, and you feel like that God's not going to answer your prayer because you failed. All right. Because some of us, we judge people based on what they do. God doesn't do that. You know, Jesus is a friend of sinners. I mean, I saw a friend of mine on the news standing next to Donald Trump, a pastor friend of mine. There were some pastors, and then there's pastors that don't like that the pastors got with Donald Trump. And so, well, Pastor, what do you have to say about it? I don't have nothing to say about it. I'm trying to talk to you about the difference between law and grace. I'm not mad at anybody. I'm not mad at Donald Trump. I'm not mad at President Obama. I'm not mad at people who like President Obama. I'm not mad at people who like or dislike Donald Trump. You know, I'm not mad about none of that stuff. I'm not perfect. I have opinions and things like that. But the thing about it is that none of us can keep the law. That's my whole point in all of this. And I bring those names up because they, you know, people can relate to it. Jesus died for everybody. Huh? Hallelujah. If the president walked in this church or any political candidate would walk in this church right now and come and sit down, okay? What's your attitude? What's your thoughts? What are your thoughts about it? What are they doing up in here? They just trying to, you know, we going to this, oh, they just here for this, or oh, they just here for that, or Donald Trump got these pastors around him just so that blah blah, and you know we got all these opinions, and see, man, I'm deep into this. Seems like I can't get out of it now. It's y'all are, okay, y'all not doing me right today. But if I got you to think, then that's good, because I'm. If somebody that, like some figure, like a Donald Trump or Barack Obama was in front of you and you got a little upset, you got a little stirred up because you don't particularly care for them or whatever, you know what, you're human. And you can't keep the law perfect. Do I need to bring up some of your Facebook posts? So that I can bring you to the end of yourself? Some of the comments that you make about people that Jesus died for? That's the only time I bring up the law. It's like people, they get outraged about something and they go attacking people that Jesus has died for. And I'm not pointing my finger at you because I don't post that stuff. It don't mean I don't think some of them thoughts that you post, and that's just as wrong. You understand what I'm saying? This stuff is in your heart too, right? And I haven't read nobody's post, so don't unfriend me. I don't have anybody in mind, and I don't even know if you wrote anything. So don't say, Pastor, I know he was talking about, no, I'm not. Don't say that. Because I haven't read, I can't even think about anybody's post. I don't go trolling and to try to find out most of the time. Sometimes I do, but see what you guys are saying. Galatians 1. Now, I marvel, if you're with us for the first time, you say, Pastor, what are you talking about? We can't keep the law. The law is a ministry of death. And you know there's a curse associated with trying to keep the law. I mean, it's deep, man. I mean, this is deep when you're trying to get right with God by keeping the law. The Bible says you are under a curse. And I don't want nothing to do with a curse. Amen. And see, that's what religion does. Religion tries to do things. Some religions knocking on doors and passing things out and trying to see if they're going to be in that number at the end. It's work-based. They're trying, if I can just pass out enough watchtowers, or if I can do enough of this, then God will say, man, you know what, you did a good job. No, we're justified by faith alone. The righteous shall live by faith. Faith in what? See, when you see that in the Bible, there's four times. The righteous, the just means righteous, shall live by faith. It's talking about living by faith in the finished work of Jesus. Our whole life, we're declared righteous by faith. It doesn't have anything to do with what we do. We're not judged for our sins because Jesus was judged already on Calvary. Sin has consequences. If you go murder somebody, if you go commit adultery, lives are affected by it. You're not judged by God because all the judgment was on his son. You're not judged for your sins. You're judged by your sins. Huh? What did he say? I said, you're not judged for your sins. Jesus was judged for your sins. You're judged by your sins. Sin has consequences. When I say judged by your sins, your sins have consequences. You get caught in adultery, you come back home, your kids looking at you in the face. It's like, hey, everybody, what's up? What's for dinner? It's like, wait a minute, dude. Right? So you're going to have to deal with some things. God loves you and he doesn't judge you, but you got consequences to deal with when you're living in sin. Amen. I marvel that you are turning so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. See, anything other than, back that up, anything other than the gospel of grace is different. It's a different gospel. According to the scripture, we should stay away from it. Look at this. And he says the grace of Christ, he's saying it two ways, saying the same thing two different ways. Let's look at the next one. Which is not another. Say, everybody say, which is not another. Come on, y'all get off of, man, maybe I should just rewind. Maybe I didn't go over the message title, just maybe lost some of y'all. Just be free, man. Just be free. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm free. I tell you what, I ain't mad at nobody. Not mad at you. And you know what I had to learn to do too? Is I didn't want to be a grace snob either. And I know that Jesus loves those religious folks too. You know what the law will either make you a rebel or a self-righteous hall monitor. You're just going around pointing at people's faults all the time. And that's what the law will do to you. There's nothing good that comes out of the law, I'm telling you. There's not another, but there are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. You see that where he calls it the gospel of grace and the gospel of Christ? He's saying the same thing two different ways. The gospel of Christ is the gospel of grace. What's grace? God's unmerited favor. Okay, let's go on. Here, y'all ready? Brace yourself now. Now, sometimes people come to church, I think they seem to think, like, okay, I'm just coming to what are you doing? Well, you going to church? Yeah, I'm going to church. You going? Yeah, I'm going. You know, and kind of go to hear a sermon or something. I want you to actually think about these words. I want you to contemplate and meditate on what Paul is saying, because you could have been taught so wrong for so long that you can think that what you think you know, you think is the truth. And it'll cause you, when you read scriptures, to just like kind of gloss over it and skim the surface and not really see it because the way you need to see it, because you're looking with religious eyeglasses. Let's just look at the scripture with no preconceived ideas. Even if we, you know, Paul's pretty hot here. Now, I'm teaching Galatians on Thursday night whenever we're taking a break from Thursday night right now. But see, Paul is upset right here. I mean, he's dealing with these Galatians because these Judaizers, the Galatians were a primarily Gentile church. They were non-Jews. And Gentiles, in other words, if you're not a Jew, the law was never meant for you anyway. A Gentile was never required to keep the law. And that's double ridiculous for somebody who's not a Jew to go on trying to keep the law. But see, these Gentile believers were being troubled by these Judaizers that came in and said, along with believing in Jesus, you also need to keep the law. And Paul's upset. He said in one place, like, who bewitched you? In chapter 3, he said, you foolish Galatians. And so you got to understand that. I'm a teacher. I can't go too fast. I mean, I see stuff in scripture, man. I want you to just kind of get the backdrop behind this statement right here. He said, even if we, including myself, or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you. I'm trying to feel Paul right now, man. He said, even if we and an angel from heaven. That's pretty deep, man. Preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached. He said, let that preacher be cursed. Paul, you don't curse an angel? He said, yeah, if they're giving you anything else. Whew. How many of you know we're not under a curse? So let him be a curse. You think he just kind of taking this lightly? No, watch this. He wants them to get it. He mentions it again. He said, as we have said, in case you didn't hear that, as we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches, this is not the same verse. He's telling them twice. If I say again, if anyone preach, Pastor, why don't you go on to something else? Because Paul ain't gone on to nothing else yet. He's still trying to get you to understand something. If anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. I don't want no curse. There's a curse on people that preach the law. I didn't say it. Paul said it. Somebody whispered, that's good. Somebody just whispered, that's good. That's encouraging me, because y'all looking at me like I just fell off the moon. But I'm going to keep on going. I'm plowing right here, man. But Galatians 3, 10 and 11. This is out of the New Living. But those who depend on the law to make them right with God are under his curse. And I can't give it to you no plainer than that. So when you mad with Donald Trump, know that God still loves you. Otherwise, you'd be finished, man. with your bad attitude and your haterade, man. You hating on the president, hating on Donald Trump, hating on your person on your job and all that kind of stuff, man. You couldn't have no blessings on your life with your old funky attitude. Why are you mad at me? I just might as well keep on going. You're mad at me right now. God still blesses you. Because it's not dependent on what you do. We are made right with God by faith in what Jesus did for us. And it's all about Jesus and his finished work. So when I fall short and I don't love people just right, and I don't love somebody on a particular day with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength, and I don't love my neighbor as myself, God just keeps right on loving me. Aren't you glad about that? Boy, that's freeing. But when you do, but see, you're under a curse when you're trying to make yourself a hall monitor. Because see, that's these self-righteous people, they think that they keep the law and they turn around and point at everybody else. Jesus got a word for you. Okay? Take the that plank from your eye. Then you'll see clearly to take that little thing you see in somebody else. Those who... She's fixing me up, man. I had that down there for real. I was trying to be cool. No. Those who depend on the law to make them right with God are under his curse. For the scripture said, curse is everyone who does not observe and obey all the commands that are written in the book of the law. And I couple this with James. It says, if you try to keep the whole law but guilty in one point, you're guilty of everything. God doesn't grade on curve. You're trying to keep the law, I mean, it's all or nothing. So it's clear. Say it's clear. Clear. Am I making this thing clear?
Yes.
I mean, the scripture speaks for itself. It is clear. Say it is clear.
It is clear.
What's clear? Huh? Huh? See, that's your issue. That's your issue. You're always trying to say stuff. Just read it. Just read it. That way, see, we also need to know what to explain to somebody else and point them to scripture. What's clear? Just read it. That no one can be made right with God by trying to keep the law. Who can be right with God by trying to keep the law? Because Pastor Al said that?
No.
The word says that, right? For the scriptures say. So, okay, so Paul, how do we get made right with God? It's through faith. And it's by grace that you're saved. Through faith. And not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. We got a lot of boasting going on. Because people think that they can be right with God by keeping the law. But the scriptures say it is through faith that a righteous person has life. So this is not just to get you saved, but this is how you live. By grace through faith, a righteous person lives by faith in the finished work of Jesus. Well then, now, see, then you can understand what Paul is saying. See, living a Christian life, somebody said, man, it's hard living a Christian life. No, it's not. It's impossible. When you're trying to live it yourself, I mean, you can't do it. And so this is what Paul was trying to explain, and people stop reading the Bible, and that's the mistake. They're getting into, Paul is telling you that you can't live the Christian life on your own. Can't do it, it's impossible. In Romans 7, that's what he was dealing with here. He said, well then, am I suggesting that the law of God is sinful? Of course not. The problem is not with the law. The problem is with us. He said, in fact, it was the law that showed me my sin. See, get the purpose of the law. It was the schoolmaster or our tutor to bring us to Jesus. Once we're in Christ, we're no longer under the school and the tutelage of the law. He said, well, it was the law that showed me my sin. I would never have known that coveting is wrong if the law had not said, you must not covet. Man, for years, I never understood this scripture. Man, Paul, what are you tripping about? Let's go on. But sin used this command to arouse all kinds of covetous desires within me. See, there's only one good use for the law, to bring you to the end of yourself. Like when I mentioned that stuff about Barack Obama and Donald Trump, and for those of you that people think, oh man, I'll keep the law. Then when I mention that stuff, oh, okay, I guess, okay, I got some work to do. But you don't have to work, that's the thing, you don't have no work to do. When they went up to Jesus made this thing so easy. Let the Bible, I love when the Bible answers questions. They came up to Jesus one time and said, Jesus, what must we do to do the works of God? That's a loaded question, man. What must I do? Jesus said, believe. Believe on him whom he has sent. Any more questions? That's it. Believe. Watch this. Yeah, we're supposed to do good works and things like that, but that's a whole nother subject. But you start with believing. Paul labored. He said, I worked more abundantly than them all. But see, it was Christ that lived in him. See, he understood that in Christ's reality that I've been crucified. I died. I'm not trying to live this thing on my own. I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I don't got to die to myself. I'm already dead. I live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He said, I'm living by faith. I'm justified by faith. That's how I'm living. Okay, let's go back here. He said, at one time, I lived without understanding the law, but when I learned the command not to covet, for instance, the power of sin came to light. See, that's what the law does. It arouses sin. And he said, and I died. So I discovered that the law's commands, which were supposed to bring life, brought spiritual death instead. Sin took advantage of those commands and deceived me. This is so plain. And it used the commands to do what? To kill me. That's what the devil does with the law. When you try to keep that law, he'll take that law and beat you over the head with it and show you all your faults and all of those internal thoughts and all the things that you think about what nobody else knows. But still, the law itself is holy, and its commands are holy and right and good. But how can that be? Did the law, which is good, cause my death? Of course not. Sin used what was good to bring about my condemnation to death. Interesting. Remember we read in 2 Corinthians 3, 7, and 10, I think it was? Chapter 3, verse 7, verse 10. The law is a ministry of condemnation. It's a ministry of death. So we can see how terrible. See, sin used what was good to bring about my condemnation to death, so we can see how terrible sin really is. It uses God's good commands for its own evil purposes. So the trouble is not with the law, for it is spiritual and good. The trouble is with me, for I'm all too human, a slave to sin. So you see there, Paul struggled all his life. No, he's bringing them to a point. This is life, trying to live it on your own, trying to live the Christian life on your own. Okay? Now, and verse 18 says, and I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do, this is why living the Christian life on your own is impossible. Amen. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. Have anybody ever been there? Anybody tried? I'm going to raise both hands. Trying to do right. Trying not to do wrong. And then wrong slip out. All of us were in that boat. Some still are when you're trying to keep this law. Verse 22, I love God's law with all my heart. That's all of us, man. All of us that are born again. He said, but there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Thank God. See, don't stop reading. Thank God. He said, the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see how it is? In my mind, I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. But see, the answer is Jesus Christ. If you go on in chapter 8, he said, there's therefore now no condemnation. Now, let me, in the time remaining, let me hit these two stories. I made reference to them, but I want you to see. Sometimes we make a mistake just making reference to the scripture, so I want you to see it for yourself. Here's a guy. Once I understood grace, I started reading the Bible differently. I mean, it just opened up all kinds of things. See, I saw this guy. I used to look at this story of the rich young ruler as a guy that did pretty good. I mean, Jesus said, dude, all you got to do is clear this one thing up, and you're good. And I used to preach, man, that dude was doing pretty good, man. He only like missed it in one area. All you got to do is fix that thing. But what I failed to realize is the dude didn't want to fix it. There's no evidence that this dude ever gave a nickel to the poor, let alone sell all he had. There's no record this guy ever given a nickel. He walked away sorrowful. But see, once you understand grace, you'll be able to see this clearly. Look at verse 18. A certain ruler asked him, saying, good teacher. Now, he didn't even really see Jesus in his rightful place as God manifested in the flesh. He thought he was just a good teacher. And some people, they just want to be taught, but they don't see Jesus the way he is. as our Savior and our Lord, not just a good teacher. We don't go to the Bible just to get principles. Jesus gives us life. Hallelujah. So here's a guy. He said, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now, he's really a self-righteous person. It's this really coming to Jesus, believing that you're justified by what you do. And he said, okay, what can I do to inherit eternal life? So Jesus said, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. He said, you know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. He didn't give them all of them, but he said, you know what they are. Honor your father and mother. And he's just answering the guy's question. What do I do? Okay. Jesus said, you know the commandments. Do this stuff. And you know what he said? All these things I've kept from my youth. What a self-righteous statement. So when Jesus heard these things, he said to him, you still lack one thing. Sell all you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. And but when he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. He ended up walking away sad, sorrowful. The law, there's a reason for that. The law demands perfection. See, he came to Jesus asking the wrong question. He couldn't keep the law. He went thinking he could do it. How do I inherit eternal life? Jesus said, do these things. And I've kept them all. I kept them all. From my youth, you lack one thing. Jesus knew what he lacked. He said, it was covetousness. And Jesus addressed that. So why didn't he do it? He thought it was something he had to do. Because he thought that justification comes by what you do. He couldn't do it. He goes away, walking away from the one who could give him life. But he's trying to get it the way he wanted to get it. When you come to Jesus, you give up your plans. And you want to do it his way if you're going to have life. So he goes away sorrowful. See, the law demands, grace supplies. Grace causes change from the inside out. People think grace will cause you to sin. No, no, no. Grace will produce change from the inside out. This guy is trying to do it from outside in. He wasn't able to do it. He walks away sad, and there's never any record of this guy ever given a nickel, let alone selling all he had. Now, I think it's very interesting that chapter 19 comes after chapter 18 in Luke. Because it gives us one story about a guy that's trying to be justified by what he did. And then it goes to this guy who is a tax collector, Zacchaeus, in verse 1 in chapter 19. A totally different, just a contrast to what we just read. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus who was a chief tax collector. I mean, he was like one of the head honchos in the IRS. And he was rich because he stole from people. He cheated people. Okay? And tax collectors back then, not unlike it is today, are looked on as kind of scum of the earth. So he sought to see Jesus, to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. And so he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. Now, this man is a sinner. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, stop cheating and stop stealing from people. No, he showed him grace. Make haste and come down, for today I'm going to stay at your house. He's coming over to his house. He's not judging him. Jesus was a friend of sinners. I know you thought if he was down here today, he'd fix everything. He'd be different than what a lot of people think. Okay, Jesus, here's what I want you to do. We need to follow Jesus. Jesus don't follow us. Jesus, here, I want you to go march into that White House and fix the president. I want you to go over there and tell Donald Trump and just go ahead and get him. See, Jesus wasn't about that kind of stuff. Because they thought he was going to come down and fix everything and that was going on in the world when he came. And he wasn't the kind of Jesus that they were expecting. He was the Jesus of the scripture, though. And Jesus was a friend of sinners. Whoever you think is a sinner, he would be a friend of them. Think of the worst sinner that you can think about. Jesus would be their friend. Oh, man, Zacchaeus was excited. He received him joyfully. Okay? Man, he called, got his cell phone out, called Angie's, man, bring those ribs over here. I know you put your grill away, but would you bring them ribs, because Jesus is coming to the crib now. No, he didn't eat no ribs, though, did he? Because he kept the law perfectly. That's right. Okay. That's why you got to check out everything the preacher says through the scriptures. Okay? Amen. Now, I know he had an iPhone. He was calling people up. He called the caterers and so forth. Okay. Next verse. But when they saw it, they were happy. They was happy. No, man. He over Donald Trump's crib. I can't leave that alone, can I, man? They're complaining. I got to bring it down to a level where you see, we read the Bible and say, yeah, right. I wouldn't complain. No, you didn't know Zacchaeus. They didn't like Zacchaeus. But Jesus had attitude. I love him. I don't like him. But I know everything about Jesus and how he treated Zacchaeus is he loved this man. But they complained. They said they thought they had a reason for their complaint because he's a what? He's a sinner. But who are they? Where's my cell phone? Gosh. Hold on. Hold that. I just have to get the look on y'all faces today. I mean, I'm sorry. I just we do a panorama on a panel. Yeah, I gotta do it, man. Is this message that bad? Okay. Oh no, y'all see y'all blew it, man. Y'all blew it. Y'all posing. Everybody, man, I gotta figure out how to get this done. Okay, so he's gone to be a guest with a man who's a sinner. They're complaining because how he's treating this guy. Next verse. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, Look here. I give half my goods to the poor. And if I've taken anything by from anyone by false accusation, I'll restore fourfold. Hold it. End of message right here. Let me show you something. You see how different this is? How grace produces change from the inside out? Jesus didn't go in there telling him his faults, corrected him. Tell you what I do if I got around a guy like Donald Trump. He said, when I go see him, I told you I wouldn't give my opinion. I'm gonna give you my opinion based on grace. If I had an invitation, the Lord told me to go, I would go and I would love him. I wouldn't point out anything, any faults. I wouldn't try to pick out stuff I don't like. I would love him if I had an opportunity, and I would just share the love of Jesus with him. Well, I would, no matter what I said, I would be sharing the love of Jesus with him. I'd be giving grace to him. And I would want him to be better after coming from my presence because I present him Jesus. And you just fill in the blank. Anybody. Man, we should get in people's presence and not point their faults out. Because people are tired of that. That's the reason why people don't come to church. Don't get around people and point their faults out to them. Give them Jesus. Amen. Jesus never asked him to do any of this stuff he did. But when you receive the love of God, when you receive God's goodness, it is the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. It's a transformation from the inside out. See, what religion tries to do is produce behavior modification. What the gospel does, it produces transformation from the inside out.
All right, welcome back. I'm so glad you joined us today. And I hope that this experience was a blessing to you. I hope it encouraged you and built you up. And know that God is not mad at you. He's madly in love with you. It doesn't make any difference what you've done, mistakes you've made. You are forgiven. All your sins are forgiven. So look to Jesus. Don't look at your past. Your future is bright. The best for your life is yet to come. Because the past is gone. Jesus is the author and the finisher of your faith. You can make it. Don't try in and of yourself to try to be good. You are good. Don't try to be righteous. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. So I hope you tune in again for Church Online. Right now we're going to receive our offering. And so if you would like to give to help support us in what God has called us to do at Summit Church, and our desire is to get this word of God's grace, the gospel, to as many people as possible. And your giving, your financial support, and also your prayers helps us to do that. So if you would like to give, click the give button in the upper right-hand corner of your screen, and you can give securely, all right? Thank you for tuning in, and I hope you join us again for Summit Church Online. God bless you.